welcome to the Institute of International Relations. My name is Benjamin Tallis. I'm a senior researcher here at the Institute in the Centre for European Security. Also the editor-in-chief of New Perspectives, the journal, English language journal, published by the Institute of International Relations, and together it's the Centre for European Security and New Perspectives that are putting on this event today, where we're delighted to welcome Dr. Antoine Bousquet, who is senior lecturer in international relations at Birkbeck College in the University of London. Antoine's work, I'm sure, is familiar to many of you. His main research interests are concerned with war and political violence, the history and philosophy of science and technology, and social and political theory in the digital age. He's most known as the author of The Scientific Way of Warfare, Order and Chaos on the Battlefields of Modernity, which was published by Columbia University Press in 2009. And he's published various articles in a range of leading journals, including one that's just coming up in Critical Studies on Security, and other leading journals in the field of international relations. But he's also written on a number of other topics, including, you might be surprised, that Ernst Jünger, Heidegger, and the problem of nihilism in the age of total warfare, but also on assemblage theory, including in Simon Curtis and Michele Acuto's incredibly short, accessible, yet influential collection on reassembling the international, a text that I often refer to, of Antoine's. Here in Prague, Antoine gave a fascinating talk last night on the function of the image in the age of mechanical destruction. The echoes about the Benjamin will be clear there, but there are many other echoes that resonate through his forthcoming work, The Martial Gaze, which is forthcoming with Minnesota University Press. He's been working on issues related to how the eye goes to war, as it was termed in one presentation, I seem to remember, for many years. But I'm glad to say he saved some of his newest and most exciting material for us here today. The disappearance of the battlefield in the age of global targeting is the topic for today's session. And we are joined by Mark Galeotti from the Institute of International Relations, who's going to serve as the discussant. And it's particularly fitting that Mark will be our discussant today, because the disappearance of the battlefield clearly plays into narratives that we hear quite often about hybrid warfare, non-linear warfare, the merging of politics, social life, and military work, military life, warfare, in various fields, and indeed various spaces. So we'll see what Antoine has to say today about the disappearance of the battlefield in the age of global targeting, and then we'll hand over to Mark for some comments, and then we'll also be opening to the room to take your comments and questions, and we hope for a lively discussion today. So please join me in welcoming Antoine Bousquet.
Thank you, Ben, and Mark, and everyone at the Institute for inviting me and all of you to come and hear me talk. So what I want to talk to you about today is the notion of the disappearance of the battlefield, of the idea that the battlefield as a discrete space is one that's increasingly coming under threat, and with that, a changing conception of war altogether. But perhaps the place to start is to start thinking about what the classical image of the battlefield might be. So what do we conventionally associate a battlefield with? Well, it might perhaps evoke a bounded physical space, typically a field, in which densely concentrated armies meet by mutual agreement, or at least tacit mutual agreement, and clash for the duration of a single day. These are the kind of images that the battle evokes. It's also not merely a discrete bounded physical space, but it's also a specific normative space that's distinct from civilian life, in which individuals can kill and be killed, not by virtue of their individual identities, but through their association with a larger collective. You are entitled to kill others because you're fighting under a flag as part of a collective identity. And some of the normal prohibitions on killing and on violence that you find in civilian life are suspended. In the ideal, the action conducted upon the battlefield is to produce a decisive outcome, perhaps even one that determines the fate of the wider war and allows for the restoration of peace. So in our history, as we always think of significant major battlefields, Waterloo, for instance, that are said to have ended a conflict, to have brought a particular outcome. And we know, of course, that in the writings of Clausewitz, the battle takes on this very significant decisive function. Clausewitz believes that if you want to wage war effectively, you have to seek the decisive battle, you have to defeat the enemy in the field of battle and resolve the political conflict, change the balance of forces as a result. Now, although this traditional figure of the battlefield persists in our collective imaginary, again, our heads are full of traditional historical battles, our fictions, our films continue to depict this vision of conflict through this figure of the battle. But I want to submit to you that in reality, it has all but disappeared from the contemporary landscape of war. Mass concentrations of forces pitted against each other in combat still happen. We can still see things that we might recognize as battles. But I argue here that these take on increasingly a peripheral role. Outside of the special case of urban sieges, infantry troops are typically scattered across terrain, moving in small units and involved in sporadic skirmishes, no longer the massing of forces in restricted spaces. The last major tank battle took place over 25 years ago in the Gulf War, and that was an incredibly one-sided battle at that. There hasn't been a large-scale naval battle since World War II. That's not to say, of course, that military violence hasn't persisted, but the tendency for it is to be punctually unleashed in a manner that does not conform to spatial contiguity or temporal continuity. We don't have this unity of time and space which the conventional battle or battlefield entailed. Targeting increasingly appears truly globalized, designed to deliver force anywhere a threat is identified. In a classified memo of 2004 that was subsequently leaked, a memo by Donald Rumsfeld, we find Rumsfeld expressing the notion that today the entire world is a battlespace. But of course, to speak of a global battlefield is tantamount to saying that there no longer is a battlefield. If everywhere is a battlefield, then there are no battlefields. Since, as I said it out, the battlefield presumed that it's a discrete, specific space that can be distinguished from other spaces. The contemporary manifestation of wars, furthermore, seems to lack clear temporalities. Declarations of wars and armistices are out. You no longer formally declare war against other states. You no longer come to formal cessations of conflicts. If you go by the international laws of war, the United States and the UK have not been at war with anyone since 1945. That's a pretty dubious assertion when you think of the number of deployments of force. In terms of the legal category of war, that has not happened in over 60 or 70 years. Wars, consequently, even if they don't legally have that correspond to the category, simmer on indefinitely, punctuated by sporadic operations, and certainly not settled by an almighty clash of arms. There is no big battle that's going to settle Afghanistan, Iraq, and so on. Indeed, the dominating narrative of the 21st century speaks to these themes. The global war on terror, a conflict that is global and waged on an idea of terror which doesn't have any clear endpoint. In some ways, the Obama administration's attempt to move away from the rhetoric of the global war on terror ended up or yielded an even more revealing term, overseas contingency operations. Says what it does on the tin. These are operations that will happen when it's contingently necessary. Again, no definite end, no perspective on a cessation of these operations. We also see that the anonymous and the accidental enmity of soldiers, in the past you are part of the armed forces, and so you might be brought into conflict with the enemy, but on an anonymous basis, effectively, in terms of the identity of individual soldiers. This seems to be increasingly giving way to the targeting of specific individuals on the basis of their known identities, or at least their observed patterns of behaviour. So think, for example, of the campaigns of targeted assassination that the United States has prosecuted in northern Pakistan, in Somalia, in Iraq, in Syria. These are individuals who are either known because they're formal identities have been identified by intelligence services, or they might be simply individuals whose behaviours mark them out, and connections to other individuals, mark them out as suspicious and fit for elimination. All of which, I think, all of the above, suggest that the battlefield might well be in a state of terminal crisis, and with it, a certain conception of war. Having said that, I think, in truth, perhaps the battlefield has been in crisis for quite some time. This is actually not new. Maybe the battlefield has always been in crisis. Maybe the battlefield has always been an inconsistent and partial idea. Perhaps the high point, in retrospect, of this classical image of the battle is to be found in the Napoleonic era. Again, no surprise that Clausewitz is the arch theorist of the battle, given that he was shaped by the experience of that war. But already by the second half of the 19th century, commentators were noting a creeping extension of the battlefield and a dispersal of forces upon it. By the time the First World War had settled into protracted trench warfare, the battlefield was looking like a very different place. Now, key to this transformation was the increased range, accuracy, and therefore lethality of firearms that was made possible by the technological advances of barrel rifling, conoidal bullets, and smokeless propellants. So, for instance, if you look at early musket technology, or earlier musket technology, for instance, what would have been available in the Napoleonic Wars, you would see weapons that really cannot attain armed ranges beyond 75 meters. So these are very imprecise weapons, and hence the main mode of employment of these weapons is to fire them en masse, and just spray lead at the enemy and hope that you hit something. But by the First World War, snipers could hit targets at distances of 300 meters. Today, these ranges have grown further. Common assault rifles can fire further than 300 meters, and contemporary sniper ranges extend as far as 1,200 meters. So we've caught a dramatic increase in the lethality, accuracy of the common firearm. A similar story can be told about artillery in this period. In the US Civil War, artillery could only fire reliably at visible targets, targets that you could actually see with the naked eye from the position of the weapon. But by the First World War, ranges of 20 kilometers were possible. So this dramatic increase in the range and the accuracy of fire in the late 19th century, early 20th century, has two important implications. The first is that it makes exposed forces increasingly vulnerable. Where protective cover is unavailable, concentrations of force tend to draw attention and risk incurring large losses from aimed fire. The second effect is that you have a reduced need for the massing of forces in order to have effect. So instead of having to mass loads of soldiers so that they fire together at an enemy, you can distribute forces on the battlefield, use sniping tactics, and so on. So both these effects, the increased vulnerability of exposure and the reduced need to mass forces to have an effect, both contribute to an emptying of the battlefield, a dispersal of forces in the arena of conflict. In the First World War, this literally takes the form of the no man's land, a strip of terrain between enemy forces in which no physical presence can be found. Now, this correlated process of expansion of the battlefield and dispersal of forces has only intensified in the following 100 years. So here, for example, you see a table that provides estimations of the area of operations, of the length of the front, of the depth of the rear, throughout vast span of history. And what we can quite clearly see from the First World War onwards is a massive extension of the space that is an arena of conflict, and therefore of a corresponding fall in the density of the occupation of the battlefield. Individual soldiers are individually occupying larger and larger spaces. Of course, following the First World War, this extension of the battlefield also extends vertically. So we move into the battle space, so to speak, with the volumetric expansion into the airs. This extension of the battlefield, fall in the density of the battlespace, is accelerated by two further factors: the increased mobility of forces permitted by their motorization, and the development of information and telecommunication technologies that allow for the coordination of remote units. Central to this increased accuracy of targeting is the particular role of aerial bombing, notably with development of precision-guided munitions, say laser technology or GPS, in the last three decades. So for instance, if we look at the number of bombs required to hit a target, in the First World War, you needed about 9,000 munitions in order to destroy a fairly large target of the size of a building. This, today, could be attained with a single, maybe two if you want to be sure, guided munitions. So there's a quite dramatic change in the economy of force. We simply don't need the same amount of resources to have similar effects. But something else also happens in the 20th century that contributes to dissolving the boundaries between the spaces of war and peace, between the military and the civilian domains. War increasingly became total, calling upon the sum of a nation's industrial and popular resources. So at this period of time, we see the emergence of constitutions of so-called home fronts. And here, I'll show you a couple of slides of World War II posters that were published in order to mobilize domestic populations that expressed this idea that in total war, the domestic front, the economy, is just as important to the war effort as the front line. And what's striking is if you look at the kinds of messages that are produced both by the liberal democracies, by the Soviet Union, and by Nazi Germany, you find very much the same rhetoric. You are the front, everyone to the front, and so on. So there's a kind of logic of total war that seems to have traversed very diverse political systems in this period, and all have the effect of collapsing the distinction between spaces of war and peace. Victory in this period increasingly appeared to hinge on the superior mobilization of one society and the endurance of the industrial and logical infrastructure necessary to support the military's actions. Indeed, in the Second World War, battles no longer seemed to be able to settle wars. The Germans notably had very significant early tactical successes with Blitzkrieg, but these in the long run could not translate into strategic victories. The United States and Soviet Union won in the end because they could grind out the war. They had a superior industrial logistical base, and they could exhaust the economic resources of the German state, even if on a purely military level, the forces quite evenly matched, and to some extent the Germans were superior. But one of the consequences of the home front is that these foundations of military strength also, in turn, are targeted. So in the Second World War, particularly, we see the emergence of strategic bombing, in which air power is directed towards degrading the adversary's war-making capability. Extensive studies of the enemy society's industrial base and infrastructural choke points are conducted and prioritized for targeting. So waging war in the configuration of total war means studying an enemy society from the air, notably through photographs, but also through all sorts of other intelligent sources, in order to gain a forensic understanding of the foundations of that state's economic and therefore military power, and the systematic targeting through aerial bombing in order to undermine it. Simultaneously, the morale of populations is increasingly attacked in the belief that they will engender a collapse in popular support for their political regime. So if mobilization requires infusing the population with a kind of warring spirit, then if you target that population, at least the theory goes, you will undermine the war effort. And indeed, well, in practice though, as the efforts to dismantle the economic and logistical base of the enemy proved inconclusive, bombing became increasingly indiscriminate and geared towards the annihilation of civilian populations. This is the, you know, the latter phases of the bombing campaigns in Germany and in Japan, where the Allies gave up on precision targeting and just set fire to cities in an attempt to crush the civilian support. The Cold War that followed is, in fact, nothing more than an extension of that logic. Although the nuclear superpowers soon determined that a full-blown military exchange had to be averted, the only means to avert it, or the only means believed to avert it, would be to plan every detail of just such a conflict. This is the premise of deterrence theory. In order not to have to use the weapon, you have to plan for its use in every detail. You have to be prepared to deploy it at a moment's notice. And any failing or any weakness in that, actually, theory goes, will invite a preemptive attack. So almost immediately after the Second World War, the US military began work on what became known as the bombing encyclopedia of the world. This encyclopedia, its objective was, in the words of one of its main initiators, to conduct a pre-analysis of the vulnerability of the USSR to strategic air attack, and to carry that analysis to the point where the right bombs could be put on the right targets concomitant with the decision to wage the war without any intervening time period whatsoever. So, great efforts were made to identify all these targets, to classify them using some of these similar forms, and to essentially collect all this information in order to have detailed war plans that could be initiated at a moment's notice. By 1960, the encyclopedia contained around 80,000 target listings across the Soviet Union, China, and the Soviet bloc. The Cold War consequently definitively installed a set of institutions and rationalities directed towards the initiation of a global nuclear war at the shortest notice, one that would have scarcely distinguished between civilian and military targets. I mean, there were attempts, of course, to inflect nuclear strategy to move towards counterforce strategy that would have been focused primarily on nuclear installation, but in the end, the strategy that remained adopted all along was full-out nuclear war to be waged against the totality of the enemy state and society. Whether such a war, should it have occurred, would have involved meaningful battles opposing conventional forces, we simply don't know. It rather depends on whatever might be left after the initial exchange of nuclear fire. Yet while the Cold War was defined by the permanent horizon of a global war that would happen everywhere at the same time, it's a different spatio-temporality of conflict that has emerged in its wake. One in which war definitively gives way to temporally discontinuous and geographically disparate states of violence, to use Philip Orr's terminology. States of violence that momentarily conjoin distant points on the globe. So if total war and nuclear war was decided that war would simply happen everywhere in a flash, almost in a singular moment, the condition, I think, in which we find ourselves today is more one of outbursts of violence that increasingly join very disparate spaces into single moments, into moments of intensity. Now, here again, we need to follow the evolution of targeting and the countermeasures deployed against it if we want to understand this condition of states of violence. The US Air Force today likes to boast that its nuclear and conventional precision strike forces can credibly threaten and effectively conduct global strike by holding any target on the planet at risk, and if necessary, disabling or destroying it promptly, even from bases in the continental United States. And this global strike capability, this ability to strike any point on the globe at a moment's notice, is also being turned to an increasingly granular and individualized mode of targeting. That's to say that the unit of targeting is increasingly restricted and specific. We can see this tendency through development of what's come to be known as the kill box. Kill boxes are three-dimensional areas designated as free fire zones. You open up a kill box, or someone on the ground calls for the kill box to be opened within a particular period of defined moment of time, and under certain specific rules of engagement, any entity within that box can be targeted.
Now, kill boxes were originally introduced in the 1991 Gulf War. But back then, they referred to vast volumetric areas, perhaps the size of New York City, that were to be patrolled for the aerial interdiction of Iraq or Iraqi forces. But this idea of the kill box was quite significantly repurposed in the global war on terror for usage outside of recognized war zones and towards targets perceived to be threats to national security, frequently single individuals whose identities, or patterns of behavior or association mark them as fit for elimination. So increasingly, the kill box has been shrinking to the size of the individual. The US ends up justifying drone strikes in Pakistan, Somalia, and Yemen as all being part of a single armed conflict, despite neither of these countries being recognized as war zones. So the US has been moving towards justifying what it does by talking about a general state of armed conflict in which all these countries would be more or less involved, but not normally the countries or the states, but individuals or groups within these states. I think this marks a quite significant shift in the rationale for war. Whereas the exercise of armed force used to traditionally occur within an existing battle space or war zone, in other words, you declare a space to be a space of war, and then that's what legitimizes the use of force within it. Increasingly, it's the presence of the target, wherever it may be, that justifies the use of force in that location. So when a threatening individual is identified, a space can be opened up for the briefest of intervals, and, as I say, a scale that tends to contract towards the scale of the singular body of an individual target. You're targeting a specific individual in a specific place on the world, and you're opening up a space, a kill box, for the brief moment during which force will be used. This individualization of targeting sees the US move towards redefining the legitimate space of war as wherever a designated target finds itself, inverting the customary precedence of the former. We might also want to underline here the shift in the rationale of targeting from status-based targeting against units, formations, and equipments to identity-based targeting against individuals, cells, and networks. So again, you used to target individuals because of their collective identities. Now you target individuals or networks on the basis of their identity, of their function. The spatial character of contemporary war is further complicated by the remote operation of weapon systems from control posts thousands of miles away. The operatives, for example, in these air-conditioned cabins in the American desert, simultaneously occupy spaces of conflict through their telepresence and the pacified domestic spaces in which they commute to work from their home every day. So we no longer have people deployed into, again, terrains of and spheres of war, but people who are moving back and forth in the course of a single day between zones of conflict in which they experience a kind of telepresence and the domesticity of life in the United States. This sets up a radical asymmetry in which between the combatants, if you want, in which the reciprocal exposure to risk traditionally assumed has vanished. So there's a conventional understanding of war and the battlefield in which enemies meet and fight, and there may be some unbalance in the respective strengths, but there's a symmetrical vulnerability, there's a shared vulnerability that here really comes apart. The individuals piloting drones in northern Pakistan experience no risk whatsoever. As a consequence, Grégoire Chamaillou suggested that the use of armed force comes to resemble the model of the hunt rather than that of war. In the hunt, of course, you've got a complete asymmetry. There's the hunter and the hunted. And of course, one of the consequences is that the hunted have found it necessary to adopt ever more radical forms of concealment. Now, there have, of course, been long-standing efforts to counter the vulnerability engendered by exposure to increasingly accurate and far-ranging weaponry. And these indeed involve techniques that very much resemble that of the predator-prey interactions in nature. So at the turn of the 20th century, precisely when the accuracy and range of weapon systems increased so dramatically, we see a rapid shift away from bright, conspicuous uniforms to dull colours that help the wearer blend into their surroundings. So for previous centuries, armies had adopted very brightly coloured uniforms to appear perhaps larger than they were, to build pride in the regiments, to be able to see your friendly units in the smoke of increasingly smoky environments. But with the increase in the vulnerability of forces, this is swiftly abandoned. You now increasingly have to blend into the terrain and evade detection. And from the First World War onwards, we see an increasing sophistication of camouflage. Disruptive patterns are developed that purposefully seek to use markings and color contrast to break up the form of the body and to hinder its recognition. With the further extension of military perception across the electromagnetic spectrum, think of technologies of infrared or radar, countermeasures have followed suit. The development of techniques of stealth is really simply an adaptation of the model of optical camouflage into the electromagnetic domain. But I think it's important to note that in addition to these technical countermeasures, we also encounter a more fundamental and even a radical set of responses, strategies of generalized concealment, dispersion, and expendability. The first of these approaches is to shift the arena of conflict to physical terrains in which the logistics of perception, its correlated processes of targeting, are significantly hampered. So, for some time, weaker adversaries have sought to displace conflict to the terrain of jungles, forests, mountains, where technological superiority, where accurate weapon systems are considerably impeded. More recently, it's the city that's become increasingly the terrain of conflict, and a number of commentators observe that the urban environment is likely to become increasingly the space of conflict.
And potentially mildly terrifying presentation. In order to handle that balance between fascination and terror, I hand over to Mark Galeotti.
I always like to think of myself as both. This was indeed absolutely fascinating, and yes, I think very much spoke to this, to pick up on your very last point, the way that the language of war is being replaced by the language of security. Because security is omnipresent. Security is everyone's responsibility. Security is not something that ever goes away. And the way that, you know, we have this interesting tension now between societies that actually seek actively to mobilise at all times, and Russia is a classic example where the sort of the state is clearly making this point that in some ways exactly, you know, everything is potentially deployable, whether it's the media or whether it's school teachers, you know, they all have their place in the sort of the struggle for Russian security, and Western societies that have actually in many ways are trying, while at the same time saying, you know, if you see something, say something, and so forth, but in other ways actually trying to convince societies that they're not being mobilized, they don't have to worry, that war is something that happens far away if possible, because actually that's much more comforting. So we have this interesting terror precisely between the sort of what is fascinating, which is when it's happening a long way away and you experience war through the war porn of bomb camera footage and drone songs in another continent. And the terrifying, which is this idea of trying to sort of constantly whip up this sense that actually this is an omnipresent threat. Interestingly, I mean, being by root a historian, I was trying to think about the sort of the parallels. And in some ways, this modern notion of warfare, which actually is directed not against soldiers necessarily, but precisely fought on an all-of-society basis, in some ways, the analogy that I would draw historical is actually siegecraft. When you besiege a city, and it doesn't matter if it's medieval or ancient or whatever, Sumerian or whatever, you know, yes, you draw your siege lines around the enemy city, but then what do you do? You catapult in diseased carcasses to try and spread disease in the city. You cut their water supplies. You cut their food supplies. You try and demoralize them. You take their emissaries and you impale them publicly because you're trying to terrify the people within. And that was a very, very specific situational military response back in the day. But in some ways, this is actually where we find ourselves now, precisely because we often face threats that are so diffuse that in some ways we are all at siege all the time. And in that respect, I mean, I think what this presentation very, very sort of ably brought up is actually really how 21st century war is indeed changing. Antoine, you talked about the extraordinary new capabilities of weaponry, the lethality, the range, the capacity to target, and so forth. Of course, all that comes at a massive price. I mean, I'm talking financial, obviously. Modern weapon systems cost a lot of money, ridiculous amounts of money. Every now and then, sort of, someone has fun drawing a graph showing how, for example, modern fighter planes cost more and more and more, to the point where, I mean, you know, obviously this is more of a joke than anything else, but actually sort of extrapolating to the point where actually America will be able to afford one really, really fancy fighter plane come 2050 or something. Well, okay, it won't quite reach that point. But in fact, you know, war has become, you know, proper war, shall I say, has become phenomenally expensive. It's become expensive in purely economic terms. It's also become expensive in political terms. We live in an age where even actually many authoritarian regimes can no longer as easily absorb massive casualties. Now, once upon a time, in the glorious days of empire, you could send out your regiments to India or whatever and suffer hundreds of casualties, and no one would know about it. And if they did know about it, well, there would be a handful of officers, sort of younger sons of aristocratic families, well, that was their job. And it was mainly sort of working class cannon fodder, and there's always more of them. Nowadays, we're in a situation where, because of both sort of changing social norms, but also obviously the media, you know, three guys in a helicopter shot down, and that's a week-long media fest with photographs of flag-draped coffins and grieving widows and people saying, what went wrong? Rather than just, that's war, people die. You know, there is this, we have internalized this notion that if something like that happens, it's because something went wrong, and therefore there needs to be inquiries and so forth. And the interesting thing is, and obviously I'm thinking of Russia, you know, even a regime which could hardly be described as an open and transparent democracy, nonetheless clearly has to pay attention to the death count. You know, the war in the Donbass is still not really acknowledged. If you look at the conflict in Syria, they basically created this pseudo-mercenary organization called Wagner, which is technically, I think, sort of from, you know, based in Singapore, but in practice it's a St. Petersburg-based company. It's a Russian company. It's essentially established by the Russian security agencies. It's full of Russians. And it's out there doing sort of shock troop missions in Syria. Why? Well, precisely because, whereas if you're a Russian soldier and you die, you have to have a state funeral and it has to be announced and so forth. They realized, you know, from previous experiences that they can't sort of hush those deaths up. But if it's just a mercenary, that's nothing to do with us. It's, well, some mercenary hired by the Syrians died. You know, so even they are trying to find ways of minimising their casualties. So war has become expensive politically and expensive militarily, the good old-fashioned war. Nowadays war has become something that has very few limits of range, and hence, as we've heard, there's this great desire to not be seen. I mean, when one looks at many of the American drone strikes against terrorists, it's actually drone strikes against terrorist cell phones. So if some dubious Middle Eastern chap asks you to carry his phone for a while, then let me advise you to say no. And one could regard this as an interesting symbol that we are our possessions. But again, it emphasises the extent to which precisely now actually, you know, the emphasis is precisely on not being seen. And that not being seen isn't just simply about camouflage and stealthing, but as we've heard, it's about sifting in with other populations. But it's also about not letting the other side know that you're at war with them. Now again, this is something that, for example, terrorist movements and you know, in their hyper-camouflage sort of forms can do up to the point where they strike. But how much better is it to actually manage to, even after you've struck, manage to make sure that the other side doesn't know you're at war with them? And one of the reasons why that's possible, and I think one of the sort of third great sort of factors that is reshaping war, is extraordinary interconnectivity of the modern world. The old model of warfare was also possible in some ways because, to a considerable extent, obviously there was trade and so forth, and elites would busy intermarry to stop acquiring six fingers and so forth. But basically speaking, societies were still much more sort of encapsulated. Nowadays, except for the North Koreans, and even they sort of have a thriving business in methamphetamines and fake dollar bills. But generally speaking, modern societies are all deeply interconnected through trade, through finance, through just the intertwining of populations through tourism and travel and education and such like. And so in this respect, again, we need to realise this is a process that has been happening about the globalisation of conflict. I mean, even during the Cold War, it wasn't just simply deterrence theory that kept the peace. It was actually the projection outwards of a Soviet-American conflict, and therefore it will be fought in Vietnam, in Afghanistan, in Angola, in Cuba, and so forth. Actually, conflicts could be moved out precisely because of the interconnectivity of these realms. But nowadays, we actually have much more sort of intimate interconnectivity between societies. And therefore, I think it speaks to this whole notion of this sort of current voguish term, hybrid war, which is a deeply stupid term to be using for the contemporary situation. It made sense when it was originally created to refer to some very, very specific forms of engagement, particularly sort of as envisaged by Iran or perhaps carried out by Hezbollah. But for the modern conflict challenge from Russia, it doesn't really work, but we're stuck with it as a term of art. But the interesting thing is actually what we're talking about in hybrid war is often actually two very different phenomena. One of them is the use of all kinds of non-military, non-kinetic means. Subversion, intelligence activity, hacking, you name it, to prepare the battlefield. So that when you do send in your little green men, they are in the most advantageous position possible. So if you haven't already won the war, at least you had a good head start. And this is the kind of model we saw in Crimea, we've seen in Donbass. But then I think there is an entirely separate model, which is certainly one that, when one talks to people in the Russian national security establishment rather than the military establishment, you come across, which is essentially to pick up on a really fundamental point of what is war. War is essentially a way of getting someone else, another country or another body of some kind, to do something it doesn't want to do. And sometimes the best way of doing that is to get a bunch of your guys and give them weapons and send them marching across the border. But there are many, many other ways of doing so. And I think in this situation, in which our societies have become interconnected, in which actual sort of military kinetic conflicts have become so dangerous and expensive, and ones in which there is such a technological asymmetry. I mean, the Americans, obviously, as us, are so far ahead of most of their potential rivals that it's sort of almost inconceivable to be able to fight on their terms, is that instead we have a growing sense of kind of political warfare, which is never intended to go kinetic. It's everything but. It's cyber attacks. It is exactly sort of political destabilization. It is, if you believe certain American sort of news sources, hacking to change the likely outcome of elections and such like. And this is, after all, a model of conflict which in some ways seeks to sidestep this challenge of global targeting, by not by hiding in the sense of wearing a particularly fetching bit of camouflage or hiding in a cave, but actually by shifting the whole battlefield away into the intangible, away into the moral, the political, the intellectual, the virtual. I mean, we have the discussions about, you know, I mean, the Americans have decided now that cyberspace is a military domain, which is one of these perfect sort of quick fixes that sounds good, but actually they haven't a clue about how you actually apply that. And therefore, if this is what's happening, in many ways, I think that what we're seeing at the moment is, in some ways, a kind of a return to a more depressingly normal state of affairs. Maybe the very notion that there was a binary between war and peace, and that peace is somehow kind of a natural state which occasionally depressingly erupts into war, maybe that was our little temporary illusion that was created by certain specific conditions. Maybe actually an essentially constant roiling on-off, but nobody really knows when it's off and when it's on, atmosphere of contention between states, blocks, movements and groups is actually the norm. And really what therefore hybrid war ought to be called is life. Which just sounds to me a very sort of nice damp. I had to get up at 4:30 in the morning to get on a train to come here, so if I can't spread a bit of misery, then what is the point? I mean, I think that sounds like a nice way to end, because I think precisely what I found so excellent, well, one of the many things I found so excellent about this presentation is it uncorks so many of the basic kind of epistemological questions about the ways in which you can take something that sounds as technical and tactical as targeting and use that as a way of actually exploring the whole question of what is war and what was war in the past.
Thank you very much, Mark. And indeed, anyone who's been at Bratislava main station at 4:45 in the morning will understand that indeed life is war. And indeed, perhaps potentially slightly depressing. I have a couple of small remarks to add before I give Antoine the chance to respond, drawing on indeed what Mark ended up with. That surely indeed this, the exception, was the attempt to define war as a discrete activity that took place elsewhere and outside of the normal circuits of life. And I think that's what comes increasingly across, that is actually the aberration rather than the norm from which we are now diverting. And Mark's comments about siegecraft also helped to slightly crystallise some of the thoughts I was having about your presentation, Antoine, which linked to your presentation you gave yesterday as well about perspective. And I wonder which perspectives you're coming from when looking at this, because the image that's presented of war then, war now, war changing, is very much, in my view at least, an Anglo-American perspective of that. Central Europe has a different history than the UK. Central Europe has a different history than the US. And the idea of war as being elsewhere is extremely foreign to Central Europe. War takes place here in Central Europe, be it the 30 Years' War, be it the Second World War, or so on. And actually this distinction of war happening elsewhere throughout on discrete battlefields and so on, I don't think carries geographical weight. If we think of the behaviours of Swedish soldiers in Brandenburg during the 30 Years' War, all the things Mark was talking about then happened for short periods. There may be extended sieges, but there were also then soldiers billeted with the local population, which created the local population as targets, but also created forms of interaction, both hostile, antagonistic, but also cooperative, between these different agents that were actually involved, which again blurred the boundaries. And the fact that those armies were often living off the societies they were occupying, they were suppressing, also created potentially a more total war scenario than perhaps is allowed in the narrative that you presented to us. So I wonder how this notion of appearing or disappearing battlefields would cope with that geographic difference and historical difference that we see in different regions. The second point I had was about hyper-camouflage, which I think is a really, really interesting way of understanding a phenomenon that has been described in critical terrorism studies and studies of political violence, for many years. And what we perhaps see is a further guerrillaization of warfare, the increased use of special forces that you've mentioned, this decline in visibility, which I think is contestable, but at the same time is clearly one of the dynamics shaping our current conflict. And my mind went back to Mao Zedong's old theory of guerrilla warfare. Mao famously said that the guerrilla should be to the people like the fish to the water. But it seems now, indeed in the molecular, granular mode that you present to us, that actually they should be like the water to the water. And this is the removal of the fish, the removal of that difference, I think is key to understanding a lot of contemporary counter-terrorism policy, as well as how this these notions of security impact upon our societies. Because indeed the notion that for the population here, the figure of the population as that which is to be protected, but also that which we must be protected from, where the potential come from, for attack comes from in this hyper-camouflaged world, means that the problem, the monster, if you like, is you. You have the potential not only to become a victim, but also to be a perpetrator. And this potential to flip over is, I think, key to then understanding what hyper-camouflage is actually about, and the lack of distinction between who we see as safe and non-safe populations, and so on and so forth. I'll leave my remarks there. Plenty more I could potentially add, but I'll give you the chance to respond, and then we'll open up to your comments and questions.
Okay, I think I'll try and address your questions by folding that into my response to Mark's excellent comments, and to make the historical point that it'd be absolutely correct that in many ways the conventional classical understanding of war I started off with is kind of a historical interlude. And it's quite Eurocentric, and it's quite specific, and it's quite time-bound. And if you look at the war in a broader scheme of world history, well, actually, you would find that these categories of war and peace were never clearly defined, that civilian and military spaces blended into one another, and you wouldn't necessarily find those distinctions. I think these distinctions, what's interesting is to think about how these distinctions came about in the first place. And in my sense, they are a product of, or correlate with, the emergence of the Westphalian state system. There's, I think, specific features of the development of war that tie into that. But when we think about the Westphalian state system, it's really about the establishment of states which themselves create this inside and this outside. Right? They move away from the much more distributed, overlapping forms of sovereignty of the Middle Ages towards unified, centralized states where there's a monopoly of violence in the domestic society in which the state effectively gets control, the exercise of violence, and creates pacified, broadly pacified spaces, and then intense competition with other states. In fact, the more domestically pacified society is, the more you can project force externally. What seems to happen throughout this period is that the forms of war that then appear become increasingly codified. If states recognize one another as legitimate bearers of force, and from the 19th century onwards, norms become codified as kind of international law. You start having conventions that say what you do with prisoners of war, that outlaw certain weapons. There's an attempt to restrict war or the conditions under which war can be conducted on the basis of a certain reciprocity. We're all states, we all have certain rights. Now, of course, note that when these states go outside this Western sphere, then all bets are off. Right? What happens to the colonized peoples, it obeys none of these restrictions. But the fact of the matter is that these states didn't think they were at war. They didn't think they went to war when they were colonizing Africa, because these people could wage war because they were not states. They had no legitimacy. And therefore, they had no rights in terms of any restrictions to the conduct of war. So that's what's come increasingly, of course, under strain in the 20th century. So as war became more and more total, that kind of, and the stakes became higher and higher, I think the heightening of ideological conflict as well plays an important role, those kind of restraints have increasingly lapsed. The further, I think, phenomena is, you were noting these things, is that in a sense, war, the logic of total war kind of played itself out. When you get to the point where you have mutually assured destruction with nuclear weapons, you effectively can't fight total war anymore. So total war has become this impossibility. I mean, obviously it is a possibility, but no one rationally can desire that possibility. And so there's no possibility for war nor any longer to escalate to that level. So war seems to now having seems to have been looking for other kinds of avenues, other forms of competition that stay short of that. Just a few words on, you know, weapon systems. Yes, you're right, increasingly expensive. The Tomahawk missile systems that the US sent into Syria, you know, the unit price of one of these missiles is $1.5 million. It's an incredibly expensive, incredible amount of money that was expended simply on that attack. The, you know, the most advanced stealth bomber the US possesses, the B-2, costs about $1 billion each. The US only has 20 of these aircraft and would be loath to lose any of them. The circumstances in which they're actually going to be used is not particularly clear. So there's also, you know, restrictions on how far that kind of technologically intensive war can be pursued, at least through mega systems. And you're also right that attitudes towards casualties have completely changed. You know, the first day of the Battle of the Somme, around 50,000 Allied soldiers were killed. And that's the amount of American soldiers that died in the Vietnam War. And if we think about the Iraq War, well, probably about 5,000 Americans died. And yet, you know, if you, you know, the perception was the U.S., you know, was bled by, you know, bled white by the Iraq War. You know, the public attitudes towards casualties, towards the ways in which populations can be corralled into fighting, has radically changed. Again, that means that the kind of total war that dominated the 20th century is almost impossible. And so that leads me to, you know, to thinking that part of what is disappearing with the battlefield is this conventional understanding of war as a discrete kind of activity, as something that's bounded by rules, and is giving way to, you know, a much more indeterminate condition, hybrid war or forms of rivalry that fall short of full-blown war, and in which perhaps the state is itself becoming only one of the players. So I think this is also the picture, this is what is going on here, is that there's the decline of the Westphalian system as the dominant but hegemonic system of war for organising social and political life, and non-state actors are coming back to the fore. So in that sense, I have sympathy with kind of the idea of neo-medievalism, but the idea that in some ways we might be returning to more diffuse power structures that we experienced before. But there is one critical difference between our age and, you know, the Middle Ages, and you pronounce that word, it's connectivity. You know, we live in a much more intensely globalised world in which it's possible to operate a weapon system from thousands of miles away, in which events that happen in one part of the world are immediately known to millions if not billions of people. That fundamentally alters, you know, the kinds of interactions that we have, and kind of globalises the kind of political struggles and political conflicts that we experience. In that sense, it might be that the thinker for the military thinker for our condition today is not Clausewitz but Sun Tzu. Right? Sun Tzu's idea was war is something that you're always waiting, you're always preparing for war, and in fact the acme of skill famously is to win the war without actually fighting. Quickly on your last point on hypercamouflage and your evocation of Mao. Well, I think it's interesting that you mentioned Mao, because of course you're right, Mao has a theory of guerrilla warfare. But the important distinction here is that Mao's understanding of guerrilla warfare was as a moment in a revolutionary process. You know, guerrilla warfare was a necessity because you were too weak to do anything else, but the notion was once you'd mobilised the population, you would then morph into a much more conventional fighting force and you would take the cities and you'd fight a decisive battle. You know, Mao in his Clausewitz was much more a reader of Clausewitz than he was a reader of Sun Tzu. So, in that sense, So guerrilla was just a moment, whereas I think what we're seeing now is a form of guerrilla that has no prospect and no intention to scale up to, you know, a much more conventional fighting force. It's much more likely to be an indefinite form of guerrilla with no clear end in sight. Indeed, you know, what is the strategic rationale calculus of jihadists is unclear. You know, and so I think in that sense, the kind of guerrilla we're seeing is distinct from the Maoist understanding of it. I'll stop with that.
Okay, I'm sure both Mark and I would like to come back, but what I'll do first is open up, take some questions, and we'll give Antoine a chance to respond, and then we will have another crack after that. So who would like to ask a question or make a comment? Yeah, and please introduce yourself.
Okay. My name is Tomáš Kučera, from the Faculty of Social Sciences, Department of Security Studies. I wonder whether, actually, both Antoine and Mark talked about war and basically that's the main topic. I wonder whether it's actually justifiable to call what you describe as war. For Antoine, no. You may be justified by the way of creating this narrative of technological progress from the 19th century and how actually the battlefield is extended and weapons are more precise, capable to strike distance and so on. But I wonder whether what we see nowadays is just this extension of this continuation of technological progress, or simply the fact that war became irrelevant in the conventional sense. And nowadays it's some sort of guerrilla fighting, which is more close to law enforcement, policing, that sort of stuff. Simply, it's not war. It's violence, for sure. But it's not war simply because it's not political in the sense that, it's between political communities. But if you talk about identification of targets, then it's not war. It's policing, maybe. For Mark, if you say that basically any type of sort of coercion or making other peoples to do something against their will is war, then this may apply also for marketing, commercials. Basically, political campaigns would be civil wars in this sense. So maybe if you say that the term of hybrid war is nonsensical, or their nowadays use is nonsensical, well, I'm afraid you are in a way perpetuating the same problem with hybrid war. It's simply all the other means of intrusions, what maybe Russia is doing, well, if it's not by violent means, well, does it make sense to call it war?
Thanks, Tomáš. Who else has a comment or question? Yes, please.
Alexander Milicic from the Center for Strategic Alternatives in Serbia. I was wondering whether you believe that the disappearance of the battlefield is in fact a sort of a matter of perception. Because for those who are striking, from their F-16 cockpits, 8,000 meters above, or those who are striking from New Mexico through the latest technology, the battlefield might be disappearing. But I don't think that there are any conflicts where you can really see just surgical airstrikes without being accompanied by some sort of a warfare or battlefield on the ground, guerrilla state or other conflict. Let's think about Kosovo, about even about Iraq, Syria, Libya. None of these conflicts was really just strikes from NATO or the United States. It was always also a conflict, a real conflict on the ground. I was wondering, for those people who are on the ground, be it warring sides or witnesses, one way or another, journalists, for example. I was correspondent for Agence France-Presse from the Kosovo War, 1999, throughout the entire bombing. I can tell you that from NATO's point of view, this was maybe a surgical kind of war, but from reporting from the field, it was not really exactly that. Not only in terms of collateral damage, but also in terms of the war between the Serbian and the Albanian sides. So that's pretty much my question. Is it the question of, is it a matter of perception?
One more question we'll take in this round. Yes, please.
Yeah, just a related one. I'm Gordon Niven. I used to be a war studies lecturer in Britain. What is real soldiering now then? Whether if you were invited to Sandhurst, or what would you tell them in relation to their courses on the changing nature of war, or the declining utility of military force with little reversals, punctuated reversals in logic in certain programs of military importance. I just wonder what H.G. Wells would have thought of this. Would he write a novel called War in a Time of Peace or something? I think a lot of what you said is readily understandable within the historical framework. I mean, as a strategic analyst, I find myself lacking in military history. And so I went back to John Keegan's The Face of Battle or Catherine Bourke's An Intimate History of Killing. Mm-hmm. And now it's Killing Strangers from a Great Distance. And I just wonder, what would real soldiering be if you had a group of army people in front of you? Would you tell them, well, it's really a dangerous social work? Or are you good at computer games? it's a very complicated area now, I should imagine. The other thing is, back to old-fashioned things, apart from real soldiering, is invasion possible these days? Most people would think, right, what's a primary security goal? I don't want my country to be invaded. Conventionally. And you may think in the modern era, well, we've also got to take account of, and this is very important for Western perspectives, milieu goals as opposed to possession goals. That is, you're fighting wars beyond your own territory. Power projection, which is a much more difficult offense-defense kind of equation. So real soldiering, and is invasion possible these days? Or does it have its quality?
Thank you very much indeed. I know there are more questions, and we'll give Antoine a chance to respond, and then we'll come out for the second round. Thank you to everyone who's asked in that round. Antoine first, and then we'll come to Mark for his response as well. So Antoine, please.
I mean, you raised an important question about, you know, what's the definition of war. What's striking to me is actually that this is a question that people weren't really asking 60 or 70 years ago. If you look at the foundations of international relations, all the major, you know, figures of the field thought, well, what's the point of international action? It's to prevent war. None of them spent any time in great depth thinking about what the problem of war was. For them, it was quite clear. They just came out of the Second World War. That's what war is. That's what we want to prevent. And, you know, that's about as far as it goes. The fact that we're asking ourselves these questions and that, you know, we're tying ourselves up in knots about what the definition of war is, I think is revealing in its own right about where we find ourselves. And in a sense, what we're trying to make sense of is, you know, how to categorize, distribute forms of organized violence. And, you know, you make one distinction between war and policing. But that distinction itself is a product of the Westphalian system. You only have policing as an understanding of a form of coercion distinct from military violence when you've created the domestic sphere where it's sufficiently pacified that you don't have to deploy the military, you deploy lightly armed policing forces which have to resort to very low-level violence in order to maintain order. And the fact that these categories are collapsing, and I would agree with you entirely, they are collapsing, is indicative that that partition is no longer being sustained. That's why war is increasingly seems to resemble policing, and why domestic policing also seems to be increasingly militarized. And that then touches onto the question of politics, because of course policing is not explicitly political. Right, the relationship between police and its adversary is either crime understood as a kind of social phenomena, or if it's personalized, it's criminals who have no political stake, or are not recognized as having a political stake. They are a nuisance, a problem that has to be socially managed. Never, and there's no cessation to that. You know, you never completely do away with crime. Whereas war, in the classical conventional understanding that as it emerged in the Western system, was understood to be entirely political. States, you know, go to war to serve their particular interests and compete against one another on that kind of symmetrical basis. That's what increasingly is undercut. And you see that because most of the operations or uses of force kind of deny that kind of symmetry. You know, the enemy is thought of as being often criminalized. Right? These are unlawful combatants. These are regimes that need to be changed.
not, you know, political entities that have that are entitled to have their competing political perspectives, and that we're going to have a fight about. So, yes, how we, what, you know, what we this want to describe as war is a real question, and I agree that if everything becomes war, then the concept loses its purchase. But I think we are kind of in a situation of flux where it's very difficult, where the established categories no longer seem to hold. And perhaps that I can pivot into the second question. And I mean, I'll gladly accept that the account I'm giving is kind of Western-centric, and it's an experience that corresponds to that of the Western world, and would have to be significantly kind of amended and revised if you're thinking about other parts of the world. And neither am I saying that there are no battles anymore, or there's nothing resembling a battlefield anywhere. I think I'm describing what I think is a tendency towards which we are leading. And I think this is where the battlefield also has to be thought of not merely as a kind of physical space, but as a normative space. And that normative space is precisely what comes, I think, phrase when the conventional understandings of the partitioning of violence and the legitimacy in the use of violence starts to be undermined. I think the conventional understanding of the battlefield, again, these are kind of abstractions, so in practice it was always more complicated. In reality, enemies have always been demonized and so on. But I think the battlefield as an intersubjective space in which combatants recognize one another's more or less implicitly. And I think that existed, you know, at the level of the military classes as well, who fought one another and had some kind of mutual respect for what they did as combatants. That is, I think, increasingly eroded by the shift into the framing intervention as policing, as modes of crisis management, where, you know, to use the Israeli expression, you have to mow the lawn, right? You have to keep cutting the grass to deal with this persistent problem that has no kind of political solution because the politics of it are totally unaddressed. So, no doubt there are parts of the world where, you know, wars are being fought in a more conventional form, even though it wouldn't necessarily be a Westphalian one, and in which the politics are more openly acknowledged. But I think at the level of the major players, and certainly the Western world, I think that's there's been a kind of disavowal of war. It's striking to me that politicians will talk about war all the time, but they will not use the legal category of war. They won't declare war against the state. They will use, you know, when effectively since 1945, you can't go to war in the kind of conventional Westphalian state system. You can't say, we're going to war because this is in our interest. You can only say you go to war because it's for collective security, it's for human rights, you know, and so on, self-defense. And I mean, that again ties into your question about what, you know, real soldiering might be. You know, conventionally, soldiers understood precisely that all their training was to culminate in the battle, you know, in the big battle where they would be tested and their skills would be on show. Increasingly, a lot of soldiering involves lots of other activities that are not conventionally understood to be part of the soldier's remit. Peacekeeping, peace state building, counter-terrorism, crime-fighting, organized crime, and so on. So again, I think testament to the blurring of these categories of war and policing. And in that sense, I think there is increasingly, perhaps in the soldiering community, if we can use that expression, you know, a sense of crisis. I mean, it's difficult to reconcile certain conventional martial understandings with what UAV pilots are doing. You know, there was controversy in the US when the Pentagon wanted to award special medals to UAV pilots. Some parts of the military said that what these guys are doing is not, you know, what we do. Mm-hmm. They're not putting their lives on the line. Mm-hmm. I think there's an unease within the kind of traditional military cultures as well. Mm-hmm. So, yeah, I think the nature of soldiering today has a big question mark on it.
Thank you. Mark, I'll come to you for a response, and then I have a comment as well before we come back out again.
Sure. Let me start, Tomas. I mean, yes, obviously this is the whole point. There is this massive question about what do we call it, because if it's purely in sort of technical legal terms, well, we've had a great period of peace since 1945. It doesn't feel that way. I mean, I think I mean, there is a deeply unscientific answer, which I'm thinking of the British judge who was asked, you know, what is pornography? And he says, well, I don't have a definition, but I know it when I see it. And in some ways, there are similar elements to law. I mean, I think it's likely to be, and we're still trying to work on definitions, but I think it's actually, well, who are the actors? I mean, actually, in part, I think it's state and pseudo-state structures. You know, an organised crime group, we might use the term, oh, it's gone to war with its enemies or whatever, but that's just language or whatever. I mean, I don't think it's a technical term. And likewise, however much I may dislike advertising companies, I can't quite bring myself to talk of them as war-fighting agents or whatever. But this is it. I mean, I think that precisely we are in a position where we are still grappling with language and definitions, and we have to sort of think about that. But also, I mean, I think I would question this notion that nowadays it's more about policing, because, you know, if you look at, say, what's going on in the Donbass, I mean, there you have an interesting struggle, which totally brings up a lot of these ambiguities, in that, on the one hand, you might well have small, essentially militias that are formed from organised crime groupings on the Donbass side of things, carrying out small skirmishes that actually have very little strategic purpose, but everything to do with making money, because they'll burn off 20,000 rounds of 10,000 rounds of ammunition. They'll tell the Russians they burnt off 20,000, they'll get replenished for 20,000, and they'll sell the remaining 10. And then sometimes, when, for example, Ukrainian government forces look as if they're going to be making some kind of headway, you see a surge of highly advanced Russian mechanized forces, brief, exceedingly technical, exceedingly conventional, violent, high-intensity operations, and usually only last a couple of days, which then performs its necessary function, and then the Russians sort of pull their elements out. So, in a way, you can have one conflict which actually runs that whole spectrum from what really we could think of as more banditry than anything else, all the way through to full-scale, modern, technical warfare. So, again, what do we call that? I think, likewise, Antoine doesn't need me to fight his battles, and indeed, what are battles? But I mean, I think the point about, for example, the Kosovo War, it's not so much that there are no battlefields, it's this sense of a discrete notion of the battle space and the civilian space. I mean, I think actually this is, you know, the whole Balkans mess very, very amply demonstrated the way that actually those boundaries became incredibly fluid. Gordon?
Yes.
Well, let me just start with your last thing about, is invasion still possible? Again, I mean, one could say, well, ask the Ukrainians or the Georgians. In some ways, I think what's become harder has been occupation.
Yes.
You know, in a way, the sort of, you can send in your shock and awe. What we found that we're so good at is deciding what to do next, because that's slow and painful and expensive and such like. But this question of what is real soldiering, I mean, I have had the experience of talking to young soldiers at Sandhurst about this question and didn't have a good answer for them either, really. And I mean, the glib answer is actually, soldiers, what is soldiering? It is what it's always been, which has been the final backstop of states. When states require violence, or when states require other things to be deployed. Anyway, soldiers are the Swiss Army knives of the state. Often it's the knife, but it might be the corkscrew or that strange thing that's meant to take stones out of hooves that no one really understands. Or whatever. But it is, you know, soldiers are deployed in crisis, you know, in response to disasters. Soldiers may well be deployed in support of, the, you know, aid of the civil power in terms of, you know, riots. And it is basically whatever the state wants to do with them. But ultimately, I think, I mean, although I have a lot of problems with his notion, I'm minded of Tom Barnett's idea of the bifurcated military. The idea that what America needs is essentially two separate military structures. One of them, Leviathan, is the small, violent element whose job is to go in and break things. And then you have what he called the SysOps element, whose job is precisely to fix societies and do all the kind of more softish power. Sort of stuff maybe after the invasion, or maybe it's precisely to, you know, try and bolster societies that are facing crises or whatever. Our problem is at the moment is exactly that, as at a point when war, the whole concept of war is becoming so broad, at present we have the problem of we're expecting soldiers to be able to embrace all these roles. So on one hand, they're meant to be Tom Clancy-esque, hyper-technological soldiers. But another, at the same time, they're meant to be able to put on their berets and play football with local kids wherever they've deployed. And, you know, basically every single mission in between, which tends to mean that even the best soldiers actually can often be, at best, mediocre. You know, they're the jack of all trades, you know, even while they're mastering their very sort of technical capacities. Because, exactly, we haven't yet understood war, so how can we expect our war fighters to know what to do?
Thanks, Mark. I'll take that point about soldiering first. And the reason I've got the computer open is to get the quote right. I'm sure many of you have seen Tim Hetherington's film Restrepo, American Soldiers in Afghanistan. And there's a memorable quote in that where one of the soldiers from 2nd Platoon Battle Company says, well, why aren't frontline grunts more admired? It's because everyone just thinks we're stupid, was the response. But you do all the fighting. Yeah, exactly, is the point. And it's the fighting and the dying that is the unpalatable explanation to soldiers of what soldiering actually is today. It's to go and do that dying. And that's what we said, the battlefield is space of killing, but also very much space of dying. And when we see these temporary eruptions of peripatetic battle intensity, that is what soldiers, unfortunately, are there to do. To a significant extent, and that distinction between indeed those in New Mexico and those who are doing the dying on the front is then an extremely challenging management issue as much as anything else, but it also raises these exact conceptual questions we've been talking about. A couple of other very brief points from me. One, I very much buy Alexander's point, which is I think a version of the same point I was making, that it depends on your perspective, and that indeed has to be addressed, because still I see the war from above. I see the beauty of our weapons, and I see death coming from above, and we are guided literally by those things. But again, the distinction between smart bombs and the fact there are no smart explosions is not adequately, I think, perhaps addressed in that perspective from below that is there. And that verticality of the battle space, as you mentioned, I think it's more than just a two-way story. In terms of policing, taking a Foucauldian notion of policing as government, I think there are highly political aspects to that, but they're not political in the same way that we used to understand warfighting aims. And I was drawn both by Tomáš's excellent point or question and the response to it, to thinking of Charles Tilly and state forming violence versus state destroying violence. And the notion that we don't see political violence as being able to form states in the same way that we used to, and therefore violence and war not having the same aims as perhaps we used to, is key to understanding this, what I would refer to as dilution rather than disappearance of the battlefield. And this dilution can then vary through the water, which keeps coming up as a metaphor here. It can vary in concentration at different points, and so it emerges in either stronger or weaker forms at different places and different points. And the very final thing that I would say is about visibility, because this notion of how to disappear completely, I think, is one of the subtitles in your forthcoming book, in the chapter on hiding. But there's also a chapter, there's also a very strong incentive to show and to be seen, but when to be seen and how to be seen, to demonstrate that ability to strike, is absolutely crucial to what you've been saying as well. This total demonstration of a sovereign flash, of sovereign power striking. I don't know if anyone's read China Mayville's novels, but the city where the breach suddenly appear as this problem-solving force very much reminded me of the combat cloud that can strike anywhere with the force to resolve the issue in question. But also, it's on the other side, quote-unquote. Propaganda by the deed doesn't work unless you're seen to be doing it. Why do ISIS claim responsibility for things? Why do Al-Qaeda claim responsibility? But again, then the question is when you want to make yourself visible. It is in the aftermath rather than during the course of the event, or particularly in the run-up to it. And so that battle for visibility and invisibility also then implies a battle of different logics that are going on in our cities. And I think the city, we can clearly see, is a potential key arena, not the only arena. But nor would I say is it only an arena of war, nor is it only a logic of war or security that would dominate our cities. And this, I think, is the key political struggle that perhaps need to really address, is what are our cities for? Yes, they will partly be for war, and they will partly be for defence against war, but they are for many other things as well. for economy, but also for social life of different forms, and how do we actually see this one space then being able to cope with these different competing logics of social activity and social life and organisation? And I think those are the questions that we're going to have to face in coming years. Right, second round of questions. We have time. Keep them, please, short, so there's also time for response. I know Mikhail Shumechka had a question, then we'll come to you over here. So, Mikhail first.
Yeah, well, my question has already been answered in the previous round, but basically, it referred to what you just referred to as well, that much of the sort of the perspective that Anton has and on the disappearance of the battlefield, you know, the empirical, or the points that we're referring to are, it's a very US kind of and war on terror centric perspective, because I mean, when thinking about what sort of at the moment seems to be the most, or what the the future global, the truly global conflict is, most people would think of the US China naval situation in the South China Sea, where it is very much about the battlefield or the space and the whole anti-access area of denial debate. That's the same in Europe. I mean, people, or at least in NATO, the fear is of, I mean, whether it's legitimate or unfounded, it's a different story, but the fear is of a Russian kind of military invasion of the Baltic space and then the Suwalki gap and all that, which is very much about territory and the certain battlefield. Not obviously, I would definitely take the point that the battlefield as a normative space is disappearing, but as a distinct physical space, in many of the big issues of today's politics is still relevant.
Thanks, Mikhail.
Good morning. It's Giuseppe Rossiero from the Prague Security Studies Institute. Thank you for the stimulating conversation, and I would like to start with the. One small observation. I don't know who mentioned it, that during World War II there were no real battles that were that decisive for to lose or win the conflict. And after 1945, I think that there was no real war that resembled this characteristic, where there was a big theater of war with joint efforts to put down a recognizable enemy. But I think that there were a lot of small conflicts that resembled the same characteristic of the battles of the World War II battles, meaning that losing or winning a war did not mean that the balance shifted considerably to the favor of the Soviet Union or to the favor of the United States. So my question is, do you think there was a need to connect and to use communication to join and to connect all these wars at the and like what happened, for example, during World War II with the old battles belonging to the same theater? And do you think that this interconnectivity of all these small conflicts helped in the process of globalization during the 20th century? And how this process of globalization then influenced the battlefield in the late 90s and leading to what now we have as a modern, what we can call modern battlefield?
Thank you. Anyone else? Question or comment? Speak now or forever hold your peace.
My name is Tumai from the Institute of International Relations. You have rightly said that all types of weapons are increasing its accuracy and so on. On the other hand, it seems to me that when talking about intelligence reports, sometimes the accuracy is missing, and sometimes we can read about politicization of intelligence. Several years ago we witnessed the invasion to Iraq based on the fake several days ago, we witnessed chemical attack in Syria, followed by U.S. Rocket attack on the Syrian airfield. 2 days ago, I read a very interesting article of the Professor Postel from Massachusetts Technology Institute, former advisor of the Department of Defense in the United States. And he concluded that the attack, chemical attack, was staged on the ground. It means that the blame shouldn't be posed on the Syrian government, but on the local jihadist groupings. I would like to ask you, what's your point of view as regards the contradiction between the increasing of this accuracy of the weapons and sometimes missing a real and accuracy intelligence reports? Thank you.
Super, thank you very much, everyone. So over to Antoine and then to Mark.
To your point first, I mean, clearly, if a major interstate war broke out, the forms that would take might make some of this analysis moot, or at least peripheral to what might happen. And that, of course, could involve China or Russia and the US and so on. But my sense is that, in many ways, this is still the kind of war. This is the kind of war that almost cannot happen. I mean, I don't want to exclude that it could happen, but it seems likely that none of the participants really want to get that kind of war. So these participants have to prepare for it. They plan according to their theories of deterrence and so on. They have to plan for it, and they imagine the kinds of battles they might fight. But whether these battles are ever going to materialize, I think, is a very open question. This is where, of course, your point about visibility comes into play. It's all about demonstrations of force and capability, and we're seeing a lot of that at the moment in the Korean Peninsula. The attack in Syria was really mostly about flexing and showing force rather than it was about degrading significantly in the Syrian military. And indeed, all these weapons often involve advertising themselves, showing video feeds of it. The recent dropping of the mother of all bombs, was a complete media event, right? That was what it was supposed to be, is a display of American military might. And it, of course, it does have its correlate in non-state terrorism, where the attacks are successful to the extent that they're mediatized, these attacks entirely designed to that particular end, and their visual and their reported impact is far greater than their actual physical impact. So what was the second question? Can you remind me quickly?
The need to connect.
Okay.
Connectivity, decisiveness.
But you were talking about the Cold War. You were making a point about connecting all the different conflicts that occurred within the kind of narrative of the Cold War, right?
Yeah.
I mean, I think the Cold War has played a major role in the sense that we've never demobilized since the Second World War, effectively. I mean, of course, in some ways, significantly. But prior to that, after the First World War, the belligerents massively demobilized. Military powers converted back into conventional sources of economic activity and so on. Post 45, effectively, the US and the Soviet Union stayed on a war footing throughout the Cold War. They demobilized soldiers, but they built technical systems that were designed to go to war at a moment's notice. And they built an infrastructure of intelligence agencies, of R&D departments that dedicated huge resources to planning for war and the next step. And that never really ended. Now we've moved into the post-Cold War era with these same institutions, defense industries set up, and part of the genesis of the war on terror is just to, you know, find something to do with all these resources. And that's a kind of self-perpetuating mode of engagement with the world that benefits from having a kind of narrative that can kind of push it forwards, even if the connection between these events, you know, are often quite tenuous. Most people are justifiably skeptical of the war on terror framing, and even that terminology has been dropped, and no one even speaks what we're in at the moment. It's not clear. It's just a kind of perpetual management of insecurity. And I guess that also goes to the point you were making about, you know, the natures of our cities.
Mm.
Yes, of course, our cities are not only spaces of war, in fact, that's in a very marginal aspect of what they are. But, however, the logic of securitization is now, you know, spreading throughout all the aspects of city life, right? Every dimension is liable to being securitized. You know, that you have to think, that you have to build into any infrastructure planning, any urban development, you have to build in the imagination of the catastrophic event that has to be kind of prepared for and anticipated. And finally, on the question of accuracy and disinformation, misinformation, I mean, one of the paradoxes is, of course, that, you know, the US has developed all this incredible technology. These weapons are, you know, indeed much more accurate than anything we've seen before. They can still malfunction, there's still margins of error, but it's dramatically more accurate than it was 50 years ago. And yet, the net effect of these weapons, strategically, geopolitically, is very dubious, right? What's, you know, major strategic triumphs the U.S. has been able to pull up to draw from these, from the use of these weapons? It doesn't seem to be very substantial. In some cases, the targets that are, you know, misidentified, we know that the intelligence is dubious. It might be a very big, you know, very inaccurate net that catches people who are incidentally targeted because of, you know, they happen to have to share a mobile phone with someone else. But it also never settles the situation in an indecisive fashion. We can't say that after 6-7 years of targeted assassinations, terrorism is less of a problem, jihadism is less of a threat. So I think it's not to recognize the accuracy of these weapons is not to buy into the supposed efficiency and power that they are, that, you know, the people who promote it think it will. I think we should actually be quite legitimately skeptical about it. And indeed, I think one of the challenges, and that I'll go back to, I think that's one of the points you and Mark were making, which is with this war from above, you know, the US has been trying to pursue a vision of clean war, you know, surgical war. We're just going to target the bad guys, we're going to minimize collateral damage, our soldiers will never be in the line of fire. It's a seductive vision, particularly for a society that's casualty averse, that doesn't want to put the lives of its own soldiers on the line. But to me, it seems to be strategically self-defeating, because what you're inviting the adversary to do is to do exactly the opposite. You want war to be clean? Well, we're going to make it as dirty as possible, because we know that's what you don't want. And that's what we have. We have an adversary that is completely and purposefully indiscriminate in the violence that it uses. It deliberately targets civilians because it knows that that's precisely what horrifies societies that want to fight clean surgical wars. And so I think it's utterly self-defeating. The only way you could fight these kind of wars is if all the participants involved in them share that normative commitment to it. Okay, but this is the kind of wars that we will fight. And that's never going to happen when you have such an asymmetry, when this type of war is clearly to the advantage of the most technologically advanced state. So I'll stop at that.
Thanks, Antoine. Mark, any final comments from your side?
Just very briefly, I mean, Mikhail, you mentioned, for example, sort of fear of Baltic invasion and so forth, which I think is nonsense. I mean, I think, yes, of course, everyone has to plan for it, but there is no evidence that the Russians are seeking to do so. Not least because it reflects, I would suggest, a very non-modern notion of what goals are. You know, it's not about territory, it's not about getting more populations, it's not about the Russians are sitting there thinking our economy would be turned around if only we had a million bold citizens to put in our factories or anything like that. You know, actually, you know, one of the reasons war has changed is precisely the whole notion of the kind of outcomes that what we might gain from conflict is also changing and tends to be actually sort of very different. Going on to the business, I mean, I won't really add to what Antoine has said about small wars, but I mean, I would question in terms of post 45 the idea that there haven't been wars that have been sort of classic and conventional. One can look at the Arab-Israeli wars, one can look at the Iran-Iraq war, one can look at things like the invasion of Georgia, which actually clearly sort of either were resolved or indeed failed to be resolved very, very specifically in battlefield terms rather than anything else. But I think, again, you know, actually the tide is going against that kind of conflict. It's quite specific. Final point, I mean, in terms of intelligence, I mean, absolutely, it's very tempting to say nowadays that technology allows countries the capacity very accurately to hit the wrong people. If you take those two particular examples that you mentioned, I mean, WMDs was never the reason. It was always the excuse. It was a constructed intelligence rationale for why they were going to go in against Saddam Hussein rather than because actually there was a real belief. And the Syrian chemical attack, I mean, I was in Moscow until last week, and for what it's worth, I was talking to Russian military officers, whom I've known for a long time, who had no doubt, frankly, that this was Assad who had launched a chemical attack. I mean, anyway, take that for whatever it may be worth. But in terms of the wider thing, I mean, I think, again, what this has demonstrated is that technical capacities have developed at an astonishing rate much more quickly than, shall we say, the soft capacities of proper decision-making, or proper analysis of exactly, you know, who you hit and so forth. And this is precisely the challenge. If decision making, if political control had improved as much as firepower, the world would be a very, very different place. But in some ways, unfortunately, human beings are still a fairly unreformed human being 1.0, even while our weapons have improved. But also, final point is that actually the nature of the target is also that much harder to identify. I mean, to go back, the guerrilla may not be the water in the water, but in some ways the guerrilla nowadays, or the terrorist, is the pregnant fish. In the sense of, you might look around and, oh no, this fish is okay today, but it could be pregnant next week. And I think one of the problems is precisely that we face a world in which actually our challenges are often very, very fluid. Excuse the expression. They're not nicely defined. They're not wearing a nice bright uniform. They're not necessarily from a sort of a clear state. And actually, you know, states that can be our allies, but in other ways can also be our antagonists. I mean, I think, again, the issue is much more sort of ontological. It's much more about what is an enemy these days, rather than just a straightforward, this is the guy, kill him dead. And again, that's a nice note on which to end.
Absolutely, yeah, the logic of risk rather than of threat as such in that sense is clearly one of these distinguishing differences that we perhaps see now as a dominant logic of conflict and tension. Very, very quickly from my side, when you were talking about battles and decisiveness and connectivity and so on, I couldn't help but think of the trial and the famous example of the visitor being shown around Oxford and seeing the different colleges and then asking, yes, but where is the university? And I think there is a possibility of category error that creeps in between battles, skirmishes, tensions, conflict, and war. And I wonder if we keep missing what is actually the start and end of particular wars, or if we have just failed to identify actually this war. And indeed, the point about Obama, did Obama actually lose that war? The battle for foreign policy in the United States, the battle for US positioning and action in the world, there has been a potential radical shift in that. Some would see that less radical than others, but was that actually a case of losing a war, even though there was success in particular strikes and so on? I mean, there's all sorts of interesting questions I think we can put there. But this notion of identifying the war through the battles and so on is quite key. In terms of securitization of every sector, yes, but not really. States of emergency, that allow major football championships to happen, states of emergency that allow normal life to largely continue. The fact that we won't accept that such disruption to our lives is what kind of securitization are we really talking about? Partial, ineffective, perhaps. In terms of reasons, I would completely agree with Mark. Are there ever any clear reasons for going to other one true, noble thing that one can point to and say, yes, this was the reason we did it, and that's why? I mean, causality is so complex, and that there's constructed excuses and so on, I think is really, really key to that. But it does raise a very interesting question about the policing notion of this, because intelligence-led policing and targeting is a crucial notion of that type of policing that we've come to expect. So if we see a shift to this global policing and policing of disorder, then not from a reason of moral purity or from political reason, but actually from effectiveness, this idea of understanding the target is extremely important. But the very final note to end on, I think, is indeed asking what Mark effectively asked, but in other words, war, what is it good for? And on that note, I'd ask you to join me in thanking Antoine and Mark for today's conversation. And if you get the chance, follow Antoine on Facebook, because the collection of images, or Twitter, you are on Twitter, AJ Bousquet? Yeah, okay, follow, because the collection of images that Antoine has put together there is unparalleled, I would have to say, and absolutely fascinating. So have a look, do have a look at that. And we hope to see you next time at our next event. Thanks a lot.